For his thoughts on the recent changes in the Philippine government's COVID strategy, we are joined by Dr. Joshua San Pedro. He is a co-convener of the Coalition for People's Right to Health. Good morning, Dr. San Pedro. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning, and good morning to all the viewers of ANC Rundown today.
All right, Doc, let's begin with the latest development. The IETF, according to Health Undersecretary Maria Rosario Vergere, has approved the DOH's proposal to reduce the isolation and quarantine periods for both the public and health workers. So let's begin with the isolation. For asymptomatic or those with mild symptoms, 7 days isolation for the vaccinated, 10 days for partially vaccinated or unvaccinated. What do you make of the shortened isolation period? So from 10 days to 7 days, from the onset of the symptoms, not the release of the results?
Yes, so we base isolation on when the patient experiences symptoms, assuming that they have symptoms. And for the asymptomatic, we base that on the day that they were swabbed, no? when it results positive. So isolation is just looking at how long the patient has the virus and how long they have that capability to infect others, no? Hence the isolation period. But given the changes, no, in the policy, we still have to see the evidence on what is really the basis for decreasing that period in order for us to assure our patients that they are no longer infectious at the end of the shortened quarantine or isolation period.
Mm-hmm. Isn't the 7-day isolation period, Doc, better than the previously proposed 5-day isolation period? Because in the United States, they have reduced this to 5 days for both the public and healthcare workers. But there are, of course, concerns saying, of course, there are studies saying that the most infectious period is actually 3 to 6 days after the onset of symptoms. And the only time when the infectiousness will wane is after 10 days. So what do you make of it?
Right. So when we talk about this aspect now of the CDC guidelines, so the CDC guidelines was saying that based on their studies, based on their research, usually the symptoms usually just take effect within the first few days of the illness, you know, and they become infectious during that time. But the thing is, the CDC guidelines added that aspect that after that 5 days of isolation, you still have to wear a mask for the remaining 5 days. So overall, it's technically 10 days divided into 5 days that is definitely pure isolation, plus another 5 days where they are required to wear a mask for the entirety of that time. However, in the Philippines, no, we don't really have that aspect of and adding additional days wearing a mask, since we are already wearing masks as a baseline. So this aspect of reducing it to 7 days is based on a notion of an acceptable risk. No, so how many, what is the percentage of the population that is less likely to be able to infect at the end of that time? And we have research showing that there is a significant decrease by the seventh day, but it is still not zero. It's still not even less than 5%. So that is something that, as we saw, you know, in the UK, they have to check if they test negative with lateral flow tests or antigen tests at day 5 or day 6. However, in the Philippines, we're just assuming, you know, that these patients would not be infectious at the end of the 7th or 10th day of isolation. So this has to be really scrutinized further. We are calling on the DOH to release, you know, the evidence that they're basing this on in order for us to be able to reassure patients that they will no longer be infecting other people once they're released from isolation.
Doc, are you going to support moves to require lateral flow tests for those who have been isolated to make sure that they're really not infectious before they go back to the general population? Because there are cases when beyond the 7-day period, there are still symptoms. So what will happen to them?
Right. So as it stands, no, even the persistence of symptoms is not something that hampers us from declaring a patient that they are no longer infectious. As long as it is clinically recovered, it is significantly better from when it started, then we can qualify that these patients are already clinically recovered. However, the aspect of lateral flow tests, while it is an option, we have to remember that even in the Philippines, the antigen tests are still not really established in terms of recognition by the Department of Health, by PhilHealth. It's still not really something that is part of our PDITR strategy at the moment. So that's something that the Department of Health definitely has to work on in these revised guidelines.
Mm-hmm. Now, moving on to the quarantine period, Doc, that has also been shortened for those who are close contacts of COVID-positive patients. So from 7 days down to 5 days for symptomatic and vaccinated individuals. But Verhelyi said hospitals or LGU health offices can assess whether to shorten this period further to even zero for exposed healthcare workers if they are asymptomatic. What's your assessment of this?
Well, when we talk about this quarantine period, so we are observing whether patients would develop symptoms if they've possibly caught the virus because they have had high level of exposure or they had close contact with a positive patient. So this is, I think, more concerning, especially since we are seeing patients who eventually develop symptoms even after 5 days, even after that time when the DOH is recommending for us to minimize the quarantine. No? So during your quarantine period, the rule is that you have to be, it is recommended that you be tested on the third to fifth day or when symptoms appear, whichever comes first. No? And even if your test is negative, you have to still complete that quarantine period. No? So the problem is that if symptoms will come out past that quarantine period, that raises the question, do we have to do we consider them already as past their quarantine period and thus they are not at risk to become infectious, or there is still that risk that when they develop their symptoms it is a delayed manifestation of their infection and thus become potentially infectious as well to the rest of the population.
Mm-hmm. Let's talk about testing protocols. Individuals under the A1, A2, and A3 categories, or the healthcare workers, senior citizens, and immunocompromised, will be prioritized for testing. But testing is not required for everybody else unless they develop symptoms. But you have been calling for free mass testing. Is this the right move?
Well, it seems that we've actually regressed in terms of testing. It is ironic that the DOH initially, in 2020, said that mass testing is something that they will consider when the time comes. And now all of a sudden we're hearing that, mass testing is irrational. So it is kind of ironic that we're hearing, instead of advocating for more testing, especially with the positivity rate so high, with all of our laboratories already maximized, as it stands with that still insufficient capacity, we're hearing support for lower testing. So it doesn't really add up in the aspect of really trying to find more cases and mitigating the spread. No, we're actually seeing less testing. It seems like we're going back to what happened in 2020, that we were only prioritizing A1, A2, and A3, despite the fact that we already have 310 laboratories. No, well, at the same time, we still have 28 provinces that don't have a single laboratory and an additional 3 more provinces that don't have a public one. No, there is really so much more to be done in terms of increasing testing capacity. And yet here we are decreasing the overall amount of testing.
How significant is this shift in policy in the midst of a surge, Doc? There were calls to increase testing capacity to at least 100,000. But yesterday, we only managed to reach around 79,000 tests in a day. So instead of increasing testing, you also have a key IETF advisor advocating for sentinel surveillance. What does that even mean?
Well, actually, the IATF did say last year that the goal was for us to reach 90 to 100,000 tests per day, and yet we've only managed to reach that once during the last surge in August to September. We're still not meeting that target. So it's really strange, that instead of living up to that promise, we are actually going to reduce it further and shifting the goalposts really in our targets for COVID-19 testing. Regarding the remark for sentinel testing, actually sentinel testing is something that is done in the early part of an epidemic, no, in 2019, that was something that the WHO was suggesting, when we were only starting to see some isolated and some clusters of cases of COVID, that we just have to look out for influenza-like illnesses or severe acute respiratory illnesses. So we're just looking, where would these pop up? This is not something that you would do when you already have local or community transmission, because if you have the capacity, and the Philippines claimed that it had the capacity to be able to test individuals, then that's something that must be focused on instead of regressing the commitment to testing as what the WHO actually recommended, that it is better that we test every symptomatic individual. And this move, you know, to move back to sentinel testing does not make sense in terms of the WHO guidelines for testing.
But do we have the money for it, Doc? Because Health Secretary Francisco Duque says it will take about 12 billion pesos a month if 200,000 people will be tested daily.
I think this is an exaggeration. Definitely, we have to incentivize testing in trying to bring the cost down. Actually, if we look at the costing for testing as it stands, no, testing is still largely unaffordable for a lot of individuals. The PhilHealth coverage for testing has actually even went down, no? So it's not really something that is made more accessible. It's not necessarily something that is made more affordable even. So this aspect in testing is actually something we see in the pricing, that it even allows for markup in private laboratories, driving the prices up. No? So in terms of the testing amount, no, we can always incentivize, we can always try to decrease the costs by with subsidies, looking at how much really testing would really cost, no, by looking at better ways to have a price cap, no, and removing aspects that increase profits on testing. And at the same time, approving the antigen tests, which are more affordable, more accessible, would definitely be able to empower people to access testing. But unfortunately, this is still something that the Department of Health is still reluctant, no, to do so. And this is the fastest way, really, that we can increase our testing capacity at a way cheaper price, and at the same time being able to count more and establish these amounts of cases that are piling up.
Mm-hmm. And Doc, based on the latest bulletin, of the roughly 235,000 active cases, more than 7,000 are symptomatic. Considering that many are not even undergoing RT-PCR tests, how likely is it that so many out there are symptomatic and unknowingly spreading the virus? Have we reached that point that it's no longer practical to undergo testing and do contact tracing? And let's just assume everybody could be a carrier.
This aspect, now the Department of Health actually did mention this the other night when they declared their updates to the strategy, you know, that the goal is no longer really to count the real amount of cases of COVID-19, to detect every single case. They're now shifting towards looking at the more severe and critical cases. No, so we've actually known that for a while, that we don't really know the true number of cases, given how many people are symptomatic, how many people are even asymptomatic. That's something we know less about. No, and with less testing, then we really won't know how far the extent is. So that's really something that is worrying with the move, no, to decrease contact tracing and testing. And I think we attribute this to the Department of Health's focus so much on a clinical aspect. No, they're the ones saying that testing and contact tracing don't matter when you're treating the patient. We can always just assume that a person who has symptoms is already positive, and we'll treat them the same. But the thing is, we will not be able to do proper community mitigation of cases if we don't know where they are, if we don't know who their contacts are, and we don't know how far the extent really is of the spread, if we're going to give up on testing and contact tracing, which the WHO says is the cornerstone of every COVID-19 response.
Mm-hmm. Now, what do you make of policies restricting mobility of the unvaccinated? Is this the right way to go? They're about to implement this no vaccine, no ride policy. Doc?
Right. So with the restrictions, hello. Right. Can you
Yes,
hear
Doc.
me?
Go ahead. Go ahead, Doc.
So with regards to the restrictions on the unvaccinated, we have to really look at whether the aspect of vaccination is really made equitable for everyone. Are we really ensuring that it is so easy for somebody to be vaccinated? No, sometimes the registration processes are still causing a lot of problems. No, this is not something that is easier to access, especially outside of Metro Manila, where you don't have those daily vaccination drives. No? So this is something that the government must understand, no? And really try to address that you have to ensure vaccine access and even the testing to be accessible for everyone before you declare these policies, no? That limit on people's capabilities and even their rights, no? So that's something that the government has resorted to in restricting people from doing this. But at the same time, what does the science tell us, no? So even vaccinated individuals who get the virus can also be infectious, no? So what are we going to do about that? And that's something that I think stems from really a lack of understanding of how COVID-19 continues to affect the population, and especially in how it can still spread regardless of whether vaccinated or unvaccinated. And this is something that we hope, no, that the government reconsiders and focus more on protecting the population as a whole, no, regardless if you're vaccinated or unvaccinated, because it's vaccinations are not the only solution to this pandemic.
And Doc, lastly, I want to get your sense, your assessment of how the Philippine government is handling this pandemic. We are approaching year three of this pandemic, and some groups have said that the government has practically given up in addressing this pandemic or even trying to address this pandemic. What are your thoughts on this?
Yes, it's either the government has really given up on really approaching the COVID-19 response in a way that it addresses the spread. No, so the Department of Health called this endemic scenario. So calling that COVID-19 is here to stay and that we have to live with it, this is something that is sort of an admission of defeat, no, to the spread of this virus. No, or it is an admission, no, of the failures of our COVID-19 response to be able to do so. So this is something that the Coalition for People's Right to Health has been alarmed about, and this is something that the Department of Health must address, especially in how it will communicate such changes in policy to the general public, no? Because if this whole COVID-19 response has been a failure, then it has to be addressed, especially with a change in tactics, with a change in leadership that really is needed for us to have a better direction for our COVID-19 response that is grounded in every community, grounded on evidence, and is something that is following the right of the people to health in this pandemic.
All right. Thank you so much for joining us this morning, Dr. Josh San Pedro of the Coalition for People's Right to the Health.